have been authenticated for the most part as being penned by the Apostle Paul. Someone said the Apostle Paul. And so let us have understanding that this is very serious in terms of what is written, and as much as the Apostle Paul was numbered among the apostles, but he was not just an apostle, he was given the apostleship to the Gentiles. So he was, touch someone and say, our apostle. This is who he was. He was our apostle. And that means he was given, of course, the responsibility to carry the gospel to those who, in fact, were not Jews, even though he was a Jew from the tribe of Benjamin. As he said, circumcised the eighth day, a Hebrew of Hebrews. This is what he says in reference to himself in the New Testament. We still must understand that he was given the apostleship to the Gentiles. The church today, almost in its entirety, is a Gentile church. It began on the day of Pentecost, primarily as a Jewish church, with Jews and proselytes being baptized with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or what we refer to in the scriptures as the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the anointing, whatever you want to call it. And of course, some 3,000 were baptized on Pentecost. He added to the church daily such as should be saved. 5,000 were baptized in the fifth chapter of the book of the Acts of the Apostles. And it is estimated that the church in Jerusalem, someone say Jerusalem, numbered somewhere between 8,000 and 10,000 members. So that was your first mega church. Of course, your first mega church in the Old Testament would have been the church that Moses pastored, because when Moses led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt and through the Red Sea, which was their water baptism, and under the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night in which the presence of God dwelt, then you should understand that they received their baptism in water when they went through the Red Sea. And they received their baptism of the Spirit as they were under the cloud where the presence of God dwelt. And it is estimated by Bible scholars that there was somewhere between 2.5 and 4 million people in that particular church, called in the book of Acts the church in the wilderness. This is what the expression, or this is where the expression is found in reference to the church that Moses pastored. We do not have the specific numbers, because in the book of Numbers, it says that they numbered somewhere around 600,000 footmen besides the women and children. And the women and children, I'm sure you know, always outnumber the men. Can the church say amen? And so that would have been your first mega church in the Old Testament. Your first mega church in the New Testament was in Jerusalem. And the bishop of the church in Jerusalem, if you didn't know it, was James, the Apostle James. Are you listening to me? And so then we should understand that this that is found in the New Testament that we're reading is written to members of the church. As we spoke to some gentlemen that they invited to Yaz on this past Wednesday that had questions about Romans 10 and 9 and obviously did not know his scripture. I mean, he knew something about an antecedent with regard to English, but he knew nothing about the right division of the scriptures. Apparently he meant no harm, but of course he certainly was tearing the scriptures up to try to lift that scripture out of its context and make it appear that it was a singular scripture that applied to salvation. When all of your demonstrations of salvation throughout the Gospels and throughout the book of the Acts are that men were born of water and spirit. And like the late Bishop Garfield Thomas Haywood said, if water and spirit was not water baptism in Jesus' name and receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, then no one in the Bible was ever born of water and spirit. Because everyone in the Bible that was born of water and spirit in the book of Acts, even the gentleman had to concede, was baptized in water in Jesus' name and filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. What is your point? My point is that the 21 New Testament epistles are written to those who have been born of water and spirit. And there is what is referred to in theology, even though the gentleman did not purport himself to be a theologian. He was a nice fellow, but even though he was a nice fellow, he did not seem to understand that there is something referred to as a pattern of consistency. And the historical pattern of consistency concerning the plan of salvation in the book of Acts is that everyone that heard and believed and obeyed the gospel was baptized in water in Jesus' name and received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. That cannot be changed. It can't be changed by you. It can't be changed by me. It can't be changed by anyone. And of course, individuals that want to argue the point, they can feel free to debate and argue it all they want. But it still does not change the fact that Jesus was baptized to fulfill all righteousness. It still doesn't change the fact that Jesus baptized no one but his disciples. It still doesn't change the fact that his disciples baptized people in Jesus' name. It still doesn't change the fact that his disciples received the baptism of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, speaking with other tongues, the Spirit of God gives utterance. And it would then only be that you would have to be the stupidest person on the face of the earth if you can't understand a simple pattern of consistency that's found in the Scripture. Or you just are an opponent or a person that has set yourself to oppose what the Scriptures teach. And I said to the individual, I said, while people are arguing about baptism in Jesus' name, I could have baptized you by now. And while you fussing about the Holy Spirit, you could have received it by now. But the problem is, and there is something that Aristotle is considered the father of, and that is the philosopher Aristotle is considered the father of logic, or the logos of man, or where man comes up with his own conclusions to things, and he exalts those conclusions above the Word of God. Where what man says, what man thinks, and what man has written about things supersedes, as far as man is concerned, what the Word of God has said. This is called logic. And then there came along a French philosopher by the name of, and of course, I guess he would consider himself a scholar, by the name of René Descartes, who is considered the father of reason. And he, of course, has set up this whole thing of an argument and, of course, a basis for an argument, where he has choreographed logic into an argument. And, of course, then he comes up saying that the argument is rationalism. The basis of the argument is reason. And he takes man's logic, uses it as a basis to establish an argument. The basis he calls reason, the argument he calls rationalism, and then he uses it to rationalize away the Word of God. And that's what we saw on Wednesday night. Individuals trying to interject what they thought about the Word of God and have it supersede what the Scripture says. Then someone needs to tell me tonight, can you undo all the baptisms that John did? Can you undo all the baptisms that Jesus did, even though he baptized no one but his what? Disciples. Can you undo all the baptisms the apostles did? And can you change what Peter said, repent and be baptized? Can the church say amen? In the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of... Can you undo that? If you can't undo it, turn to your neighbor and say, if you can't undo it, then you need to do it. And there's no one in here that can undo it. Because if you're going to undo it, that means you have to take it out of here. And if you take it out of here, he said he'll blot your name out of the book of life. So I'll tell you tonight, I dare you to try it. Amen. I have a dare for you tonight. I dare you to believe that nonsense. If you do it, it will be to your own hurt. Back to the book of Hebrews now, to those who are listening. These particular epistles are written to the saved. Touch your neighbor and say, this is to us. This is not to the world. This is to those who have believed, heard, believed, and obeyed the gospel of. So if you've heard it, you believe it, you obeyed it, it's to you and it's to me. Now, we don't have to receive it because God is not going to make us receive anything. Please let me illustrate one other thing before we read the 13th chapter, verse number 1. God is not going to make us do anything, but you must keep in mind, in the book of Malachi, He said, I am the Lord.